is it C45? Oh, because I changed that to 45. Okay, let's stop that. I'll be right back. That's an odd number, isn't it? Yeah, I'm streaming. And we should be focused. Okay, everything. Well, mostly.
Alright, hello again everybody. This is Mr. Everything, and I'm coming back at you with the finishing touches of the Grenadiers that we've got lined up right here. I got 30 Grenadiers, and as a special bonus, if I haven't got enough time, I'm going to go ahead and do the finishing touches on this orc model as well. This orc's name is Dave. He's Dave the Barbarian. Okay, yeah, he's in my D&D game. That's Kendall's character, actually. Okay, so what we're going to do... As you might notice, if you've been following along, I have gone ahead and painted the bases real brown. That's right, I'm using full court real brown. It's not fake, it's real brown. And what I did was I put some of this brown in one of my palette reservoirs. And then I filled the reservoir up with water. So it was primarily super watered down, almost like a wash. And then but much thicker than a wash. And then I put it on there, and what it's done is, because that is grit, which is sand and gravel, it soaks down in between the sand. So a lot of the sand grit on the top, because I primed everything black, the sand grit that's raised is still black because the brown washed down around it, leaving black on the top. That's fine. That's what I wanted, because I just want down in the deep cracks to be a dark brown, and then I'm going to highlight it with a light brown. But we're going to do that later. What we're going to do now is I'm going to use this gunmetal gray on their barrels. And this is this one right here. It's an experiment, so bear with me. We're gonna try it on a couple of barrels. We're going to see if, in fact, this is the color I want to use. If it's not, I'll go grab one of my Vallejo paints, or I'll go grab one of my other metallic colors. Oh, excuse me. Oh, really? Look at that. No, you can't see it, but... It looks like the paint has dried inside the nozzle. I'm seeing dried paint right there. So what do I do? Ah, you heard that, didn't you? Shake it up a little bit more. I'm kneading the bottle. I'm just trying to break up any paint that might be lingering, sticking to the sides. I know it's probably not, but... And then sometimes I'll even take the paint bottle and I'll roll it in my hand like this 100 million times just to get it mixed up. And then I'll shake it from end to end. Alright, that should be good. Maybe. Who knows? Give it a shot. I don't use a whole lot of this color. That's why it's an experiment, because I don't use it a lot, I don't remember if it's going to be good. It seemed to be very thick, so I needed to put a water on that. A water droplet. And then I'm going to take... Yucky! I'm going to stir it up. Now, I know the modern rifles, and I assume the World War II rifles, I'm not really sure, but I'll have to do a little research on that. I know that U.S. rifles, there was a bluing technique. The, like you go through and you soak the metal in a solution that puts a bluing. Okay, I'm not going to do that one first. I'm going to do that one first. And the bluing actually makes the metal black. So you could actually just leave it black if you wanted. But we're not going to do that. Why? Because it's a game. It's a figure. It's a figure. Or some would say, a figure. A miniature. Okay. Even though I did the bases over an hour ago, they're still wet. So, I don't want a dry brush on top of a wet base. Okay, so on camera, you see the metal. It looks good, actually. It's metallic, but it's not so metallic. I'm going to sneeze. Tissue over here. So that one actually does look pretty good the way it is. I wonder why this looks kind of golden. Copper. Oh, I remember. Because I dipped it. Okay, so let's paint another one of these rifles. Now, whenever you do a metallic color like silver or gold or any kind of gunmetal color, you want to paint it on top of black. Because it makes the it enhances the metallic color. If the metal doesn't stick, okay, metallic paints don't usually stick to every part of whatever you paint it on. They usually are kind of watery or whatever. They'll move around and they will separate. But if the undercoat is black, it still looks really good. You know? Let's get some light on that. That doesn't seem focused to me. Does that look focused to you? That doesn't look focused to me. There, that's better. That doesn't look good. I think I'm going to do all these with this color. Okay.
I'm digging it.
Okay. Kind of like, black doesn't really work very well with yellows and reds, but it does work excellent with metallics. If you're ever planning on painting something yellow or red, You want to make sure that the undercoat is white. Now I have the sniffles. But metallics, the undercoat needs to be black. And I believe any military model should have an undercoat of black anyway. That's just me. Now the only thing that I'm painting metallic like this is the rifles. The mag, well, any part of the rifle that would have been metal, like the magazine, the rifle barrel. I don't think the STG handle is wooden. I think it's actually also metal. I should have done some research before I committed to that, but yeah, you know. And by the way, I did. Okay, now I told you that I painted these camouflage smocks, or I guess they're not really smocks. I guess they're ponchos. They're zeltbons, which it basically means it's a tent. Quarter, because four soldiers would get together and they would snap all their tents together and it would form one tent for four soldiers to sleep in. That's what this camouflage pattern is. It's the it's actually called a splinter pattern. Okay, the pattern that I painted on here. Now, the splinter pattern has a bunch of these little green lines. I mean, super small green lines in them. But at this scale of a miniature, it's really hard or not necessary, I should say. It's not super hard. You could get in there and make these little lines. There'd be like each model would have like 100 of them on them because they're super small little hash lines all through the camouflage. And at this scale of a model, I don't think it's necessary. That doesn't have anything that would be metallic. Okay. MP40. And on the metallic, you're not really looking for 100% coverage. It shouldn't matter if something doesn't get painted, because what you're kind of representing or what you're simulating there is that the bluing that they would normally have done on the rifle is now being rubbed off or exposing the metal underneath. And remember, those black lines, they really make a difference on the way the model looks. So you want to leave some black lines in there. See how that one looks? You got black lines. It really makes a difference. And metal, the metal paints have a tendency to separate, remember? So you're constantly stirring or mixing up your paint in your palette. If you're using a acrylic. And I only use acrylics anymore. I don't use any enamels. I don't think I use any enamels. Main reason is because of the acrylics are water cleanup. But one of the main another reason is you can thin it with water and you can mix it and not have too much of an issue. Flying through these guys pretty quickly. I painted a wood handle on this guy. Huh. Maybe they are supposed to have wood handles. I might have to go back and paint some wood handles on these. As a follow-up. You see on this rifle here, you got the wood handle. Yeah, it's probably the way it's supposed to be. I mean, most of them have someone holding the handle, so you don't even get to paint the handle at all because the hand is covering it. But just in case, you know. There is a lot of reference material online. I'm old school. I've got books. But you can go, you can Google almost any German camouflage or American uniforms or anything. But beware, anybody and their brother can get online and post something and say it's official when it's not. So just be careful. I ran into that problem when I was making my World War II 101st paratrooper uniform that I have, you know, for reenacting, and there was something I put on the uniform. I'm not going to go into all this detail, but there was something I put on the uniform, and then I got a bunch of people, a lot of people actually, said, that's not the way it is. It doesn't, they didn't do that. That wasn't on the 101st. That was only on the 82nd, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, okay, they might be right, you know. So I took their word for it, but did I take the item off of my uniform? No. What I did was I immediately initiated a research. So I went around, I looked around. I live right next to Fort Campbell. If you didn't know this already, I live 5 minutes, maybe less than 5 minutes away from Fort Campbell, the 101st. And I used to be in the 101st. Okay. But I was never in World War II, obviously. You know, and I really didn't pay attention to the World War II uniforms as close as I was when I was making that uniform. So I decided, okay, let's go over to the 101st Museum and take a look at one of those uniforms. Because they have them on display. And lo and behold, it was there. It was on there, and I was like, those idiots. Paint the drum as well. Why not? I wasn't sure if the drum should be metallic or not, but I gave up and said, yep, okay, stir it up. Yeah, the paint will start to separate in your palette, so it's all right. A little stirring goes a long way. Damn, these Germans are really starting to look good. I don't know what you guys are thinking out there. But I would definitely be proud to show these off at a tournament. Yeah, I know, pride's a sin. But they're not talking about this type of pride. Yeah, I would definitely be proud to show these off at a tournament. Be like, yep, look at what I can do. And how's that guy go in Mad TV? Look what I can do. Ah! Oh, goodness. Yep, that one's got a wooden handle as well. So some of these I have wooden handles and some I don't. That was my mistake. But that will be fixed in the post-production of Grenadier Painting. Now, Grenadiers are basically, it's just a term for, that's just a term for German infantry. You can make them SS, you can make Panzer Grenadiers, you could make them just infantry. You know, these guys could have been scout troops from like a recon platoon or something. They pretty much can be anything because the uniforms were similar enough that you could model them with pretty much whatever you want. A little bit of converting here and there, you could have done anything with these guys. But they are definitely late war with the assault rifles. If you were doing early war, you don't use the assault rifles. But I think you pretty much have to, because I don't think they give you enough CAR 98s. They might, but I just don't think they do. Okay, those guys are all metal. Nice. There's my arm and the camera. Look at my hair. Okay, I'm stirring the pot over there. There we go. Trying to clean the brush up for a little bit. Okay, so there's really only two or three or four models that have the ammo belts over their shoulders. So what I'm going to do is get a second pallet. My overflow palette, right? And then I'm going to get some brass, which I've got right here. It's my Vallejo brass. And remember, there's only a couple of figures, so there's only a couple of things that need to be brass. So I don't want to waste my brass by putting too much brass into the palette. I just put a itty bitty drop. I'm going to mix it with just a little bit of water, very little, almost less than a drop. I'm going to use a smaller brush. I'm going to use a 3-0 brush. I'm going to mix it first. Okay, 3-0. Where is a gunner? Okay, so looking at these assistant gunners, you see that they're carrying or I should say they're not carrying, they've got these ammo belts slung over their shoulder. What I plan to do is paint the whole thing brass. That's not really what happens. The cartridge is brass, but there's down the center of the belt, there are these things called links that connect the brass from one to the other. And as it fires, the links go flying as well as the brass. But the links are usually like a black metal color. And so what I need to do is put like a black line right down the center. And what's really cool is they've modeled the links. If you look really close to the ammo belt, there's actually a raised area right down the center of each of the cartridges. Sweet. Sweet, sweet, sweet. I'm gonna do some inside work. Not a whole lot, just enough to make it look like I did some inside work. Yeah, I just sent a text to Dave. I know it's super late to be texting somebody, but I sent one asking him if he wanted, what time he wanted to make his character tomorrow, because he's joining our D&D game. And I don't anticipate a response until maybe tomorrow. But, you know, what the heck. Bam, that looks good. That looks good. You notice how I left a little black line right there between the hand and the belt? I do that throughout the entire model. Okay, this guy does not have an ammo belt. Weird. This one does. Also, by doing the metal after you do the dipping, it stays, and remember, after you do the dull coat, it stays shiny. It doesn't get all dull or dirty from the wash. Because you don't want it to be either. You don't want it to be dull or dirty. And but it's okay if it was, because guess what? They're in the field. They're soldiers. They're not dolls. All right, this guy's got an ammo belt. Now, I think I had an extra machine gun. I had three extra machine guns and like ammo cans and belts like this that I didn't use, because I anticipate maybe down the road needing those bits for some conversion. So I deliberately left them off of these models. I guess I could have put an ammo belt on all of my assistant gunners. But I wanted a little bit of variety, as well as I wanted to save some parts for the next time. All right. That gunner's got his ammo belt. He doesn't have one. He doesn't have one. So I guess there's only three ammo belts? I'm kind of looking over all the other figures, and yep, that's it. There was only three. All right. So the brass is done. Okay. Black, I think, is the last thing I need to do. Super thin black lines. Now, I'm not going to use a 3-0. It's too big. I'm using a 5-0. Oh yeah, that's nice and thin. A 5, but where's my black? Where's my black? I'm not using black, now that I remember. I'm not using black. What am I using? I thought I was using, like, black. Okay, maybe I'm using this burnt umber or something. I'm trying to remember what I had planned. Because burnt umber is like this really dark brown. Because if I use black, it looks too black. I don't know if that makes sense. I know I'm. Let me get the other burnt umber. There we go, another burnt umber. Because I have almost out of this one, that's why I have a second burnt umber. If I had like a black brown, I know that's weird, right? I think that's what burn umber is. Cleaning my paint bottle. There we go. Now, some paints from the Folk Art line, some of the older ones anyway, have these giant mouths on the paint bottles. I think those are totally too big, and they've pretty much gone away from that, which I'm glad they did. They've gone to the smaller holes. Okay, does that need... I don't think that needs water at all. Okay. So the main thing that I'm worried about is the straps on the back. Now these guys, I have to focus, be really careful, very little paint, and just take it nice and easy. Okay, so you get like the little Y shape on the back. Looking good. Got to be real careful not to paint something you don't mean to paint. That strap didn't go all the way up to the fold yet. There we go. This takes a lot of concentration. I'm not ignoring you guys, I'm just concentrating. Some of these guys are like really hard to see those Y straps on their back. Kind of have to figure it out. And then again, on some of them, it's super easy. Like this one. And then on some models, you ask yourself, is it even worth painting it? Because it's just a very small little piece. I say, sure. I got the paint out, so why don't I just go ahead and do it? Not only am I painting those straps that go over the shoulder, but I'm also painting their belts this color. Belts and the rifle ammo pouches. Okay. Squad 2. Hopefully by the time I get all their straps painted, then I will be able to dry brush the base. And then apply some flock. Hopefully. As I can see, the bases are still just a little bit wet. Okay. Paint was starting to dry on the brush, causing it to not paint well. Losing its tip, basically. So just clean your brush a little bit. actually. It's amazing what a little brush wash will do for you. Looking good. Okay, so that's half of them. Oh yeah, I forgot I need to highlight my flesh. Okay, especially on the faces. We'll do that before I flock. Good, looking good. What I had to do is all of the straps on that guy because he's pretty much not carrying anything. All right. Down to the last 10. Eight guys. Down to 7. All right, we're down to 6. What am I doing next? Oh yeah, a little bit more of flesh. I'm not doing eyes. I'm gonna save that to another video. I'm going to do a tutorial on how to do eyes. I will do eyes on these later. Maybe during flesh. Nah. Maybe in a future video. Okay, there's only 5 left. Just gonna brush a little bit. Alright, here we go. Thank you. So I'm sniffling between every miniature. Three left. Not counting Dave. Something I learned a long time ago when painting. Don't force the paint off of your brush. If you touch the model and the paint doesn't go onto the model, that means you don't have enough paint on your brush. Don't like push hard or stroke. Just touch and let the paint flow. Unless you're dry brushing, of course. That's a totally different effect. One guy left. Some chin straps just have to be painted. Because they were just so blatant, you know? Okay, so while we're waiting for the bases to dry, because I can already tell they're not, I'm going to go get some sepia tone. Okay. This is a sepia wash. I'm not even going to thin it out. I'm going to put two drops in my palette. Okay, and I'm going to use a O brush because that's how I roll. And I put it over the face. And the hands, the arms. And I push it off to the side. With particular attention to the fingers the ears, the eye sockets. Yeah. Because what it does is it'll bring out all of the features. This the sepia is kind of a brownish color. It's kind of a yellowish brown when it dries, so it's perfect for like as a flesh wash. It's also perfect as a camouflage wash. It's perfect for almost everything. I'm going to show you an example of a hand and how it transforms. Okay. You see the hand there, on the pistol grip? You take some sepia and you put it on that hand. I don't know if you can even see that. And when it dries, well, let's roll it the other way. Well, to me, I can see it makes a big difference. On the camera, I don't know. It just doesn't look like it's making that big of a difference. One good thing about the sepia wash is it's not a paint, so it doesn't get in and ruin any of the detail. It basically just, it's more like an ink. So it gets into all the nooks and crannies and settles down in there and darkens them up. You can use the sepia wash on anything on your model. It'll bring out any details. It will darken everything a little bit. It will darken it a little bit. A lot like the Minwax did. Just makes the guys look like they've had some sun. Maybe they're Africa Corps veterans. They've got a little bit of a tan. When you go to paint your Africa Corps, if you have any Africa Corps, you want to make sure you definitely use some kind of flesh wash to darken everybody's skin. Now, when I'm talking about highlights, I meant that I was going to highlight the flesh. This is not a highlight. This is a wash. This is the opposite of a highlight. A highlight would be like if I went over and touch the nose with some paint or a cheek. But I wanted to make sure I washed the faces before I did that. I still plan on doing that, actually. Because, oh, look at that. Because washes are inks, they don't dry as fast as acrylic paints. I think I need another drop. And that's amazing. One drop. So basically three drops. A drop per 10 models. That's pretty good. One drop. Like this guy's got his mouth open. Well, he just got a bunch of ink in his mouth. And it really makes him, it really accentuates the fact that he's got his mouth open. It's like looks like he's yelling. Like, ah! Or maybe, hey! Hey, what's up? No. Probably not that. Probably Vasislos? Or Nixhesen? Except I guess he wouldn't be saying Nixhesen if he's aiming a Panzerfaust statue. That's kind of like counterproductive. Oh, if I get some ink on my uniform, no big deal. If I get some ink on the rifle, good. That'll make it look even better. See how you pretty much can't see any facial expression on that guy at all? And now you can. Wow, I've been doing this for an hour and a half already. I didn't anticipate being that long. But we are almost finished, and I guess I keep dragging it on. I could already be finished. I could just flock these guys and be done with it. But I want to make them look good. Last one for the wash. Sepia wash is done.
Okay. Take it back just for a second.
Taking a couple minute break. Just bear with me. All right. Yeah, I'm gonna have to. gonna have to go back over these guys with flesh and highlight them. Which flesh is kind of a, highlights are gonna be like a dry brush almost. Well, exactly. Base is almost done, almost dry. I mean, I can see that it's not dry there and there. Some of them are pretty close to dry, some are not dry. So maybe after I do this flesh dry brush, it'll be dry. So I get out my small dry brush, which is a stiff bristled brush. Get out my flesh paint. I'm gonna put a drop of flesh out.
A pint of flesh.
No. Not adding any water. Rubbing 90% of it off. And then just barely going over my flesh model. That looks good. Okay. Just to kind of give you a comparison. See how that guy's face looks? It's not bad, but you can see where the ink pooled up in some places that don't look good. And then look at his hands, how they're probably just a little bit too dark. So then, this is after I go back and dry brush. Hey, football man, what's up? Yeah. Yes. Okay, the question, can the German infantry have a Panzerfaust and also a weapon? Yes, they can. Once they fire the Panzerfaust, then they just can't use it again. It's a one-shot deal. Your soldier can run around firing his rifle as normal, and then if a tank presents itself, you know, or you're in range or whatever, then yeah, when it's your turn to fire, you can opt to fire at the tank with your Panzerfaust instead of your rifle. You can't fire both, obviously. Not in one turn, anyway. But yeah, he can alternate back and forth. Well, not back and forth, because once you fire the Panzerfaust, it's done. There is a suggestion, which I don't think anybody in their right mind ever does this, but that's to model a guy with a Panzerfaust, and then model a guy without a Panzerfaust, and then once the guy shoots the Panzerfaust, replace the model with the guy without a Panzerfaust. And I'm like, that means you have to have, for every Panzerfaust, you have to have a second guy. No. I don't think anybody does that. You just know. You and your opponent just know that he's already fired. Yeah, that arm looks way too dark. Alrighty. Sniffling all over the place over here. I must have already done this guy. Looks like I've already brush stroked this guy. And if not, well, he just looks good already. Okay, here we go. Yeah, these guys look good. Only a few of them look like they were excessively, you know, oh no, what did I just do on this guy? Okay, that's okay. It was just that I thought the paint was a little thick there initially. Once I get this flesh done, this is the very last thing I'm going to do before I dry brush the base and then flock it. And you'll notice, I don't know, you'll notice that flocking just brings the paint job to the next level. Initially, I used the wash on the uniforms. Initially, I used the Minwax Poly Shade as a protective sealant. It's polyurethane sealant, but it's also a stain. So what it winds up doing is it washes the uniforms. But if you don't want to polyurethane shade or protect your models in that way, you want to go a different route, you can always use the sepia tone, sepia shade from Vallejo. I use the sepia shade for everything that I'm washing, pretty much everything. Flesh, uniforms, weapons. It doesn't matter. If I'm gonna use a wash, it's gonna be the sepia tone. But like the wash that you see on the uniform and the helmet and the rifles and all that stuff was done when I did the poly shade. Which I think was last night's video. Yeah, this has been a week-long project that I've been working on. And every night I've been streaming, oh man, this wash looks good on, or this dry brush looks good on this guy. He's real, wait, what's this? Gotta fix that. Easy fix. His face looks really good. I'm really excited about that guy's face. Okay, I know it's hard to see on this camera. I'm actually shopping. I'm probably going to get another camera. One that can handle high resolution and zooming in. This one can't zoom in. That's a problem with it. I can zoom in, but I have to bring the model, the camera, like super close. I mean, it can do like a macro, like I can get really close to this model and show you, but I have to get, it'll have to be like way up here when I'm zooming in. You know, I have to bring the model way up here and go, ooh, check that out. Well, it's not zoomed in now. I don't have it focused, but that's where it would be. Ooh, okay, here, his hand needs a little touchy, a little touch work. And boom, done. Oh my gosh. Oh my god, this guy needs a lot of work. He's good. Ooh, yep, he's good. All right. How about this guy? He's looking all right. So if you're just getting into bolt action, what army are you planning on playing? Are you planning on playing the Germans? Are you planning on playing the British or the Americans, the Russians, or any of the minor nations? Free French, whatever. Who are you playing? Or do you plan to do everything like me? Well, I don't plan to do everything. I just plan to do Americans and Germans primarily. I got a friend that's super excited about the Russians. I'll probably be doing the British as well. British para, anyway. I don't know. I like the British Tommies as well, or the Africa Corps even. Monty's guys, or the... Yeah. But I would do the British Para because Pegasus Bridge is one of my favorite little engagements. And I like the troubles that Bocage give the Americans that they have to overcome, giving the Germans a slight, like, defensive advantage there. But I also like the Bastogne, Battle of the Bulge situation where the Germans are actually on the offense, you know, and the Americans are on the defense. There. What time is it? Almost 2 o'clock? I might actually get some XCOM in tonight. Maybe not. I don't know. I've been playing that game, Normandy 44, whatever it's called. It's pretty fun. Or Steel Divisions. I guess that's what it's called, Steel Divisions. Normandy 44. Seems like it's pretty fun. Only played like 2 games, but and they're both exactly the same because I'm just experimenting with it right now. I'm not really trying super hard. I've only got my machine gun teams left, so hopefully we'll get them done in just a minute or two. But to be honest, I'll probably play some War Thunder instead. I really should be getting ready for my D&D game tomorrow, but I pretty much got ready last week, and the game was canceled, so I'm still pretty much ready for it. Pretty much. There's still a little bit of reading I need to do, but... One last one. Done. Now I just need to dry brush the base and then apply some flock. That's khaki. Okay, let me go find some goose feather. Unfortunately, this is the apple barrel goose feather. It's a lot like this color, actually. These colors are very similar. But I'm going to use the goose feather. Not going to use this tray, though. Hang on. Use the overflow tray. Okay. I don't think I need a whole lot of it. I've got a really wide stiff bristle brush for this purpose. I always use this brush here for my terrain. And flock is, in my opinion, is considered terrain. All right, here we go. Let's spread these out just a little bit because I don't like the way they're so tight together and I can't reach down into the model and stuff. Stuff and things and jazz and stuff. This orc is in the way. Okay, so here we go. A little bit of touching into the paint. A little bit of rubbing the paint off into the palette. And just quickly... rubbing it over the base. Trying to avoid the boots. And if he's kneeling, trying to avoid his pants. Not trying for 100% coverage here, just trying to highlight the grit. Make the grit kind of stand out. If there happens to be a large stone on the base, I try to ensure that that's completely covered. Again, I guess I mentioned this last night, or maybe I mentioned it earlier today. I do about 2/3 of the base in grass. So about 1/3 of all this work I'm doing on the base here will shine through. The more grass you put on your base, the better it'll look. It's just that I don't like 100% coverage. I used to do 100% coverage, but I feel that that just is... I don't know, it's too fantasy. It just looks more realistic when it's not 100% coverage, in my opinion. Now, I read an article somewhere where a guy, instead of using sand, he uses black ballast, right? And he puts the ballast on after, a lot like I do, after I base the model. I do it after I base the model so that when I prime the model, the sand gets primed as well. Well, he does it after he paints the model. And just uses black ballast, so it's already black. And I thought that was a pretty good idea, but what he mentions in that very same article makes me wonder what's going on in his head. He says, I just use black because it's ready to be dry brushed. And I'm like, wait, what? You don't paint them brown first? You just go straight up and dry brush it? No, I thought it was a good idea, but I would still paint it brown. Or use brown ballast. That might even be better. It'd have to be super dark brown. I don't know if they make dark brown ballast. I know they make light brown ballast, because I've got a ton of it. That's what's in this sand mixture, actually. But yeah, you can get this stuff that looks like coal. And I, you know, for model railroading. And I was like, ooh, coal, that's like jet black. And it's also very fine. Because it's made for model railroading coal, right? And I was like, I could probably use coal in this. But then I would still have to go back in later and dry brush them. Or paint them, I mean. Paint them brown, because I don't want it to be black with a dry brush. I want it to be brown with a dry brush, even though I use super dark brown. Actually, I think the brown is dark just because it's on top of the black primer. Okay, that sling is in the way. I don't want to paint the sling or his boot, so that's someplace that grass will have to go down inside there. Okay. This guy's got a lot of big rocks. Maybe that's why he's high stepping it. That's another thing. I'm going to have to print some character sheets for my new players so that they will be able to write on their character sheets. All right, I got two guys left. All right, here we go. Last one. Right, last one?
Yep.
Okay, clean the brush as always. I'm gonna let that dry for just a moment. While I get ready to do some... Ooh, yeah! Some flocking. Okay, when it comes to flocking, what I do is I use a tester's brush. This is just a simple, cheap old 50-cent brush. It's got nylon head. This is just to move the glue around the model. That's all that's for. And then I use an empty palette because I'm going to wash it off almost immediately. Just for a second. Yep. Let me go find which flock I'm going to use. Because I have like 100 different ones. Okay. I could use static grass, but I don't know if I want to do that. Maybe. Static
grass doesn't have a great coverage, though. Okay, I got it. Oh, glue. Alright. Okay, so what I'm going to do now is I'm going to move the camera back a little bit. Just a little bit. Give me some room to operate, but also so you can see the whole process. So now I gotta organize this a little bit so that I'm not all over the place, which I am right now. Okay, I don't need this. Having this here is fine. Having that there is fine. See, it looks like I'm in like totally a wreck here. There we go. There she blows. Okay, so here's the process. We take some glue, which this thing is apparently closed. Let's see if we can't figure out how to open this thing. Put some glue in our little reservoir, which the glare I don't think you can actually see. Then we add water, quite a bit as you see. And then we stir and stir and stir. You gotta keep stirring. Because right now, all I see is water. And a white little milky substance all the way at the bottom. But as you stir, it starts to mix. And mix. And mix. And mix and mix and mix. Okay, so now it looks like it's good. I'm going to rotate this around a little bit. So it's closer to my area of disaster. Okay. Let's grab our first model. Paintbrush, glue, and wet
the base. But not 100% of the base. Just about 2/3 of the base. We leave some gaps. Leave some holes. Okay. I don't know if you can kind of see the how I did the liquid on that guy. Then I go in, shake some of it off, put it in my tub. Okay, I keep hitting this thing. I gotta be careful not to hit it again. Alright. Go in. Shake most of it off. I'm just shaking it off, not turning it over and tapping it and all that stuff. Because I want it to kind of settle down onto the base. I've tried a bunch of different flock. I've tried Citadel flock. I've tried Static Grass. I've tried, what is that company? DreamPod 9. I've tried all different kinds. Citadel is the best, in my opinion. It has the best coverage, lays the flattest, it sticks the best. I don't know, there's just, the Static Grass just doesn't look right. You know, in my opinion, it doesn't look like grass. It looks like a mess. And it gets on everything. Yeah, I was afraid of that. Let's knock that off of the barrel. Okay. Yeah, you don't want to get it on your model, but if you do, it's okay. Because guess what? They got grass on them. Big deal. Grass stains. It happens. Now, the only reason why I water my glue down gets down inside all the cracks, but also it extends the use of your glue. So if you got one bottle and you use it and you add water to it all the time, you're getting like double the glue. Because flock doesn't need full strength Elmer's glue or whatever glue you're using. Watered down is just fine. When doing your flock, do make patterns and stuff. That's what I like to do. I like to like make little patterns with the glue. There's different colors of flock, you know? There's different, like there's snow and all that good stuff. use the one that's appropriate for the look you're going for. I'm using blended turf. I think blended turf looks really good. It's got a little bit of yellow in it, you know, and it's got mostly green. Oh, yeah. One thing, Woodland Scenics and a lot of other companies, their flock is a styrofoam-based mixture. Styrofoam that's been shredded up and colored. Where I noticed that this Citadel mixture is kind of like a... sawdust. And being that it's a sawdust, maybe is why it works the best. And not a foam-based. Got some glue on the guy's pants. You know what that means? When I put the flock on there, there's going to be some grass stuck to his pants. But you want to know what's cool about that? It'll just make it look cool. So he's got some grass on his pants. Big deal. Who cares? Sorry, I'm sniffling. I don't even know if everything's in focus or not. I didn't even bother checking. You know, everything we do here is so professional. Or maybe not. I think I'm getting low on glue. It's alright. I've got more. Where that came from? Oh my gosh. Wow. Really, Mr. Everything? Really? These guys are doing okay. But they're all mixed up now, but it doesn't matter.
They're all the same.
Yeah, none of them stuck to anybody else, so that was good. That's what I was afraid of. Like, there was a couple of them were on top of each other, and I was afraid that maybe the glue would shine through the flock or something, and then it would cause the base to stick, but it didn't. You know what, I'm going to add a little bit of glue in here. Just a little bit. A little bit of water to get through this last squad. Okay, I'm going to set this right here. Pull out my second little tray while we do the last squad. Stir this up a little bit. Looks good. I think it's totally unnecessary. I've seen some guys put like these big huge rocks on bases and stuff like that, like for the desert or wherever. I think that's unnecessary. I actually think it takes away from the model. One or two, sure, but not a rock on every one of your guys. I've seen guys at armies, and then like there was a rock based on every single one of their bases. A big rock, like knee high. And I'm like, wow, that's just too much. Now, I do mix in some rocks with the grit, but they're not. First of all, they're not that big, and they randomly get stuck to the base, because I'll glue, then I'll sprinkle the grit on, and either the big rocks will stick to it or they won't. Well, most of the time they won't, because they're too big, but sometimes they do, and then those are the ones that are on that base. I don't later go in and say, here, let me add this ginormous rock to this base just because I have these ginormous rocks in my collection. I thought about it, but I came to my senses. I said, no way. Also, clump foliage. I thought about that too. Then I came to my senses for the exact same reason. The answer is no. Why? Clump foliage and those big rocks belong on the terrain table, not on your individual models. Because your models move, right? They go from place to place. Technically, they probably shouldn't have any rocks, even the ones I put on the base. They probably should have just a flat, smooth, fully flocked base. So I make a compromise. I do a little bit of rocks. I've only got three models left, so I probably don't need a whole lot of glue or a whole lot of water. Once I get these flocked, I'm going to do a little cleanup. Then I'm going to shake off the excess flock. And then we'll do the money shot. We'll take a look at them. We'll take some close-ups. Because this is the last guy. And I will be completely 100%, okay, maybe 99% finished, because there's still a few things I gotta touch up that I uncovered. Oh yeah, dang, one more thing. It can wait. Okay, so I'm going to put these over here. I'm going to close up my superhero flock. I'm going to clean my workstation up, and I'll be back in just a few moments. Main thing is cleaning this brush. And the glue off the palette. That's the main thing. Should be it, right? That should be everything. Everything. Okay. Okay, final step. Ooh, there's a lot that fell off of this guy. You notice that not very much is falling off of these guys. I think it has something to do with the type of flock, the grit, the watered down glue. All right. Back and we'll do the money shot. Okay, so what I'm gonna do is, I'm gonna have them kind of facing. Forty-five degrees to either side in a random lineup, just so you can see. And I am also going to do 45 degrees to the rear. Sides. There, just all over the place, just so you can see. Now, let me detach this. Detach the camera. Okay, the camera's detached. Now, okay, so let me adjust some focus. I'm manually adjusting the focus here. Okay, that looks good. All right, so it's just gonna go one at a time down the line. Just taking a look at them. Tell me what you think. Other models are in the way. think what I'm going to do is stop the video. Once I get everything, once I get it all, I'm going to stop. Once I show you all, I'm going to stop the video, and then I'm going to come back and do a money shot. What is going on with his helmet? Okay, whatever. See, so you see the details on the back? You saw the details on the front? Oh wow, dang, he's like really in focus. Okay. I'm hitting models with the camera. Yeah, you're lost. You're carrying a Russian rifle or a Russian submachine gun. Tell me what you think. Inquiring minds want to know what you think. He's got some grass on his pants and his entrenching tool. Alrighty. Alright guys, thanks for coming out and checking out this video and watching me do a live stream of painting these crazy mother fractures. And you guys have a great rest of your night. Appreciate you.